Hello everyone, today we are going to have a short overview of PRES, that is Posterior Reversible Encephalopathy Syndrome. It is mainly for the MD resident who is going to appear for their exams. We are going to discuss under the headings of definition, pathophysiology, clinical features, imaging, diagnosis and DD, and the treatment part. Don't worry, the entire session will get over in less than 10 minutes. First, definition. It is the clinical and radiographic syndrome of heterogeneous etiology that are grouped together because of similar findings on neuroimaging studies. Basically, it is a reversible subcortical brain edema. So, for definition, one important point you have to remember is it is a reversible subcortical brain edema and it is both clinical and radiographic syndrome. The other names are reversible posterior cerebral edema syndrome, posterior leukoencephalopathy syndrome, hyperperfusion encephalopathy, or brain capillary leak syndrome. Multiple names have been postulated because no one name explains it perfectly. In some condition, instead of posterior circulation, anterior circulation might get involved. In few patients, it might not be reversible. So that's why many names have been postulated to explain it, but none is satisfactory. Coming to the pathophysiology, the three important mechanisms are, first, it is associated with disordered cerebral blood flow autoregulation, second is cerebral ischemia, third is endothelial dysfunction. Let us see in detail about each of this. About the cerebral blood flow, there is an autoregulation in the cerebral blood flow, which you all know, which maintains the perfusion pressure over a range of blood pressure. If the ranges crossed as in patient with hypertension, the blood vessels may dilate inappropriately, leading to brain hyperperfusion and breakdown of the blood-brain barrier, allowing extravasation of the fluid and leading to the edema formation. Second is cerebral ischemia. The disorder autoregulation may lead to reactive focal vasoconstriction, thereby resulting in local hypoperfusion and cytotoxic edema and resulting in local hypoperfusion resulting in infraction which might lead to cytotoxic edema. Third is the endothelial dysfunction. In some clinical condition which is associated with PRES like preeclampsia or cytotoxic therapy, it is postulated that the direct toxicity on vascular endothelium might lead to capillary leakage, blood-brain barrier disruption or axonal swelling which may trigger the vasogenic edema. Why the posterior part of the brain is commonly involved than the anterior or any other part? It is because of the sympathetic nerve fiber distribution. It is postulated that the adrenergic nerves around the blood vessels of the anterior circulation is somewhat more than the posterior. So the dysregulation is more common in posterior than anterior. The risk factors. The common risk factor that we encounter in our ward and in common day-to-day practice is hypertension, eclampsia, vasculitis or the contrast media exposure. Other associations are any microangiopathy conditions like TTP, TS, HSPR, HUS, organ transplantation, autoimmune condition like SLE, scleroderma, Wegener, PAN. And one important point to notice over here is hypercalcemia. Hypercalcemia might lead to this condition and also renal failure, sometimes transfusion. CNS causes Guillain-Barré syndrome, spinal cord injury and also with head injury. Head injury also leads to this condition. Drugs, any immunosuppressive or chemotherapeutic agent might lead to this condition. The common drugs that we encounter are cyclosporine, IVIG, methotrexate, rituximab, sirolimus or tacrolimus. So, remember cyclosporine is an important cause of this condition. Coming to the clinical feature, the patient usually present with seizure, headache, visual disturbance and altered sensorium. These four are the cardinal manifestation of PRES. For clinical feature, just remember these four features. Any age group might be affected, starting from an infant to the very old age group, more than 70. And the common age groups are in 40 to 50 range. Females are slightly more affected compared to males. Will you get any finding in the general examination or CNS examination? The answer is no. Focal neurological episodes are usually where the deep tendon reflexes might be brisk, plantar might be extensor. Fundus examination reveals normal finding unless the patient is having eclampsia, which might lead to papilledema. Coming to the diagnosis, it is basically based on imaging. CT and MRI are the modality. CT will lead to non-specific hypodense lesion, which is very difficult to differentiate from other conditions. So I am going to discuss only on MRI. MRI, the common area that are involved are Watershed zone, superior frontal sulcus, parieto-occipital dominance. The main finding in this process, usually both the lobes are involved and it won't be restricted to any vascular territory. This is how you will differentiate from other vascular events. And the findings are, in T1 usually you will get hypo-intense lesions. In T1 with the contrast there will be variable enhancement. Just remember, T2 may you will get hyperintensities. Diffusion weighted MRI is usually normal. This is one MRI showing the hyperintensities in the posterior region. As you shall see over here, this is another image to show you the hyperintensities. The gray matter is more affected than white matter because the fibers are densely packed in the gray matter. There are various image finding of press that you can get in Google Images. Just these are two examples. The typical finding of press on the MRI is basically depicting a vasogenic edema. Why diffusion weighted imaging is important? It helps to differentiate it from stroke and press. Although the findings of bilaterally symmetrical edema and not restricted to single vascular territory is there, some cases may it might be difficult to differentiate in T2 weighted MRI. That's why you need diffusion weighted MRI. And the important point is the findings usually resolve with the treatment. So you might require a follow-up imaging. There is no specific diagnostic criteria for this condition. So whenever the patient presented with the cardinal features of press like seizure, encephalopathy, headache or visual disturbance, and you inquire for the risk factor. As I already discussed, look for hypertension, autoimmune diseases, if the patient is on any drugs or if the patient is pregnant, always keep in your mind press is a possibility. Often imaging, that is MRI, if you are getting hyperintense lesion or bilaterally symmetrical lesions and no other alternative diagnosis is possible, we are arranging at the diagnosis of press. So as a medicine resident, always keep this possibility, like while working in emergency also. The close DDs are any vascular accident like stroke, vasculitis or venous thrombosis, toxic or metabolic encephalopathy, demyelinating lesion, any demyelinating lesion, and encephalitis. Treatment is basically supportive. We have to identify the etiology, blood pressure control, the target blood pressure control and how to reduce it in a CNS insult will be discussed in a separate video. As of now, just remember just BP control, antiepileptic can be given. If you are suspecting a drug associated press, reduce the drug dose, and if it's not possible, like reduce the drug dose and if possible stop the drug. The patient usually improves. Prognosis is usually good, it's a better prognosis. So to summarize in a single page, press, it is a reversible subcortical brain edema. It is because of the disordered cerebral blood flow and endothelial dysfunction. Patient usually present with headache, seizure, altered sensorium and visual disturbance. The four cardinal feature. You will get hyperintensity in T2 weighted imaging and patient usually needs supportive treatment. So thank you. We will meet in next video.